Hello, Curious Minds. I'm Miles Maxer, and welcome back to the Ant Network. Today, I am so excited to be answering your questions about ants and ant keeping. Unfortunately, we got so many submissions that I'm not going to be able to get to every question in this episode. If you want to ask us a question and potentially have it featured in one of our videos, make sure to send us a message either on Instagram, Facebook, or on Twitter. So get a hold of us. We are at the Ant Network. Okay. On the episode today, we're going to start out with a question from Andy Kirby. Now, Andy asks, can I keep my ants outside? My mom doesn't like indoor ants. This is actually one of the more common questions that I get from our student ant keepers, new ant keepers, anybody basically living under the purview of a parent who is skeptical about keeping ants. There are a couple of different approaches that you can take to handling that situation. So I started keeping ants, I think by 2021, it's gonna be about 11 years ago. And that was definitely when I was living at home as a student in middle and high school. And I had to ask my parents for permission to keep ants in the house. One of the ways that I went about doing that is showing them how the ants are kept in captivity. I showed them how the lids are tight fitting, how Fluon works, basically indicating to them that no, the ants are not going to get out and they're not going to infest our home. One of the most important things to do is to have an honest conversation with those people about what having an ant colony means. And what you can do is really show them that you know what you're doing, you know what it entails to keep those ants in captivity. But if they're still skeptical and they say, no way, we don't want them in the house, you could potentially keep them in your garage or an attic. But you're going to have to figure out how to make sure that you can keep the temperature and the environmental conditions stable and not within any kind of threatening range, right? So you can use a wine cooler during the winter to keep the temperatures cool but steady. And you could even use that turned off with a heater inside of it, like a heating cable or a small heating pad, to create a little bit of a growth chamber. And that's one way that you might be able to keep ants out in a garage. Unfortunately, keeping ants actually outside, probably not a great plan, but nature has blessed us with ant colonies abundant in the natural environment. So if you want to keep an eye on ant colonies out in your backyard or in the neighborhood or near the woods, hiking trail, you can absolutely do that, and that's one way that young ant keepers might be able to learn more about the ants that they hope to keep someday. AV Mermis asks, can colonies be desensitized to light? They added, this would suck for moving colonies. Absolutely, ant colonies can be desensitized to light, at least many species can. Now, I would push back on the suck part of that question, right? Because I actually intentionally condition my ants to withstand light during the day and then darkness at night. Turns out, the conditioning for those colonies allows them to be better viewed in captivity during the day. So you're not using a flashlight or other bright light that might startle the ants. They're already used to that light. So I actually find it advantageous. I also work with a mentor named Ray Mendez. He's done tons of exhibits for zoos and organizations like the Smithsonian, where you have ants in captivity always under bright light. So in those cases, it's great to have colonies that act pretty normally under that bright light without consequence. Now, if you want to have lots of lighting in your ant keeping setup, but you also have some ants that you, either for one reason or another, you don't want them desensitized to light, or maybe they're very, very sensitive ants, then you can use something like this red cover from Tarheel Ants. Now, some ants can see red light, many ants cannot see red light, but what these actually do is they just provide a darker environment for your colonies. So you can get a hold of these red plates, put them over your nests, and now this colony has been isolated from the bright light, even if some of the other ones that you have are not. So that's one tactic that you can use if that's a challenge you're facing. With regards to the moving colonies issue, I wouldn't worry too much about it because you can still induce a colony move by reducing the humidity in the old nest, increasing the moisture in the new nest, changing the heat regimen, and so forth. So there are other options for moving ants from one nest to another other than light. Ants Seb Ants asks, how can we invite more people into the ant keeping hobby? This is something that I think about constantly. We want to have more people joining us as ant keepers. We want to see that growth. And there's many things that we can do, and I certainly won't be able to cover all of those different strategies right now. But what I can tell you is that we can create a welcoming community. And one thing that I've noticed recently is that some of the conversations that we've been having with each other haven't been super respectful. So if we can return to an online community that is a little bit more accepting of people, a little bit more patient, a little bit kinder, I think that would do a lot for us to be able to grow the hobby of ant keeping. I'd also say that one of the things that really helps us get new ant keepers into the hobby is word of mouth. So if you have friends who you think, maybe they're interested in science, interested in animals, they could potentially be a good candidate for somebody that you could share ant keeping with. That's a great way to help us grow, because then they feel like they have a friend who's also interested in it. Thanks so much for your question. Miles asks, did you know that over 60% of the Ant Network's viewers aren't subscribed? Okay, yes, I did know that. But I did want to take a break in the video, remind you, make sure that you are subscribed to the Ant Network, and hit that bell icon. AntsNetherlands17 asks, is it bad to collect ant colonies from nature, established colonies? When we're talking about established colonies, we're not talking about a queen that's walking around after a nuptial flight. We're talking about a colony that has been founded maybe the year before, maybe a few years before. Maybe the colony is under a rock, in a piece of wood, etc. And folks often see these large ant colonies. They think, wow, that would be an awesome way to get a good size ant colony for ant keeping. And that can work, and sometimes it cannot work. The most important thing to think about if you are considering collecting an established colony is whether or not you can safely extract the queen or queens from the living material. So what is the risk to the colony? What is the risk to the reproductive member of the colony of you trying to either excavate them from sand, take them out of a piece of wood, etc.? Now, if you are confident about that, you should also consider the ecological ramifications of removing that ant colony from the ecosystem. Chances are, removing an ant colony that's a couple of years old isn't going to have any dramatic effect on the ecosystem, but there are exceptions. And one of those would be if you are trying to go after an ant species that is threatened in a region. So you shouldn't be trying to get mound ants from a small park somewhere in the United Kingdom, for example. It's important to really think through what you're doing, see what is that ant colony doing in the environment, or am I going to do substantial damage to a microhabitat to excavate it? If the answer is no, it seems fairly limited, then go ahead, but you got to be confident that you can safely extract the queen. You need to have a good chance of that extraction working out. Another thing you need to keep in mind is that sometimes wild ant colonies do not acclimate to captivity well. There are some species and some genera where you can take them from the wild, bring them into captivity, and they do great. It's like you started them in your own lab from the very beginning. There's also quite a few species and quite a few genera of ants that just do not acclimate to captive conditions after being captured. So it's important to do a little research, ask around in the community, see what people think, and then proceed with an informed plan. Thank you so much for that question. I really appreciate it. We get it all the time. Okay, this next question was submitted by two different members of the community, mostly Mermessia and Dragonudo. They want to know what my opinion is on brood boosting. If you're not familiar, brood boosting is the act of taking brood, which traditionally would be eggs, larvae, and pupae, from a wild ant colony and then giving it to a founding queen or a small starter colony. There are a couple of issues with brood boosting, but it can be a fairly effective way of getting an established colony going in captivity. And for some species, it may even be necessary for having any sort of good chance of founding an ant colony in a captive environment. When you're brood boosting, the number one mistake that I see is that people will brood boost with eggs and larvae. You absolutely should not be doing that. I can't even think of a circumstance where that's a good idea. The reason is that the larvae will beg and beg for food from that queen or the very small colony, for more food than they have, and it can be exhausting. It can actually kill them before the boosted workers even eclose. So it's important that you are only boosting with pupae, either naked pupae or cocoon pupae, depending on the species. Now, if you're thinking about, okay, that's fine, Miles, I'll just give them pupae, but how many? You should consider giving between 3 and 15. It's very dependent on the species, but that's a fairly good number for most ants that folks might be considering brood boosting. Also, when you're taking the brood from the environment, you want to be able to inspect it. So you either use a magnifying glass, a hand lens, or maybe even a USB microscope. Inspect those brood items, make sure there's not like ectoparasites on them, they aren't covered in fungus, etc. Make sure it's a clean set of brood before you give it to your prized queen or small colony. Thanks so much for that question. The urban ant keeper asks, why are antennae segmented? This is a great question, and I'm not going to get into the complex evolution of insects from a group of crustaceans, but essentially modern insects have three main parts to their antennal structure. It starts with the scape, or the base of the antenna. Then we have the pedicel, which is the stem of the antenna, and then the flagellum. Now, the flagellum can be comprised of many different flagellomeres. Ants have geniculate or bent antennae. That essentially means that they have elbowed antennae, which allows them to move their antenna with a lot of precision. They can either move it forward under objects, essentially, or move it back into a defensive position. Now, the segmentations of the antennae also allow for greater flexibility. So if an ant's trying to smell underneath an object, you might be able to even see your ants using their antennae to smell between the glass and their formicarium, for example. They use that geniculate antennae and the flexible antennae structure to really get a good idea of what their environment is like. You have to remember that ants are creatures that really live in a chemical world. They smell their way through their lives, and they understand their environment through what they smell. So having those fantastic structures that are really critical to how ants experience the world, that's super important, and it's very important that they have something that is flexible, but can also withstand use constantly. And that is what a modern insect antenna, or at least a modern ant antenna, provides them. All right, the last question for this episode comes from Tom from the Grubbing in the Filth Invertebrate podcast. Now, I was recently a guest on their podcast, and I talked with Tom about ant nuptial flights, ant colony reproduction, and a whole lot more. So make sure you check out that podcast in the link down below. So Tom asks, are there any ant species that should not be kept in captivity on principle? And if so, why? The answer is yes. There are many ant species that really are not well suited for captivity. I can think of Melissa tarsus in Madagascar, where they live in the live bark of live trees. In addition, they have a symbiotic relationship with hemipterans that live in those cavities. So Melissa tarsus is a great example of an ant species that we cannot effectively replicate its necessary environment in captivity. Another great example are army ants. These are ants that cannot usually be kept in captivity over long periods of time, and that's because we don't have the resources to take care of them. In the case of Eceton, which are the large, charismatic, and kind of freaky army ants from South and Central America, well, they need so much food and so much space that regular ant keepers just cannot keep up with them. That being said, there was an awesome project, I believe it was at the California Academy of Sciences, where they did bring in an army ant colony into captivity and had it on display. Unfortunately, they eventually did die, but it was an awesome experiment to see what if we fully resourced an institution and tried to take care of army ants, and it turns out it can be done, at least for a certain amount of time. I also want to add on that just because an ant species may be kept in captivity, that doesn't mean that you should keep it in captivity. You need to make sure that you have the resources, the knowledge, the ability to take care of any ant colony, or really any animal that you bring into your care. You need to make sure that they are going to be healthy and they're going to live in that environment and frankly have good lives under your supervision. So one of the ethical questions that I often ask people are, can you take care of that many ants or that species of ant given its high intensive resource needs? So make sure you know what you're getting into when you start an ant colony or collect it from the wild. Thank you so much to everyone who submitted questions. I look forward to doing more videos like this in the future. Of course, you are always welcome to reach out to the Ant Network on Instagram, on Facebook, on Twitter, and of course, down in the comments down below. Thanks so much for tuning in, and be sure to check out our recent videos. We just released a new video from our adventure in Arizona. Go and check it out. All right, everybody, take care, stay safe. Thanks for watching.